This machine is the Panther Rotor, which is used for cutting mortise and tenon joints with a router, as well as all kinds of other joints, and this video is a compilation of my build series on building this machine, all into one 25-minute video. The slides for the plunge action need to be ball-bearing linear glides because the plunge force is applied to the side, yet the action is in the middle, and that will cause racking. What I'm using is an old-style two-tiered drawer slide. I need to drill out those spot welds. In the plans, I have the ball cage being 28 centimeters long. It needs to be fairly long just to give me more support. And this one is just 20 centimeters long, so I just need to get this one out. Now I need to check the accuracy of the slide, and I'm going to do that by putting in just a short ball cage with a few balls. I have a little bit of play along the entire track. Very carefully bend this in a little bit with a vise. And then checking if there's play. So squeeze harder. And now it's still loose right there, so I'll squeeze that some more here. And now putting it back together with both ball cages, but not all the balls, because I'll have to take this thing apart a few more times before I'm done. It slides without play, and it slides smooth. I'm adding countersinks with a larger drill here. I made these two little spacers to help me position the first slide parallel to the edge. Now what's really important is that the second one is exactly parallel to the first one. I figured some sort of self-centering awl would be handy. I don't have one, but I just made one real quick. These have to be really parallel. If it's off by half a millimeter, that would be way too much. Now I gotta mount the other half of these slides onto the base, and that's this drawing here. And once again, I made spacers. I cut these as one piece, then cut it down the middle. I'd like to attach this one with wood screws as well, but this one needs to have a little bit of wiggle room for adjustment. I gotta make sure that these slides are exactly the same spacing as the ones on the top. I just drilled a series of tiny pilot holes here, which will allow me to center the drill on the other side for counterboring. And now drilling the holes for the screws. So with this one on there with screws and nuts, it has a little bit of wiggle room. Let's try to mate these together. So now this slide has made itself parallel to this one. I hope when I lock this one down, will it still slide easily? Good. When I pull these apart, this will prevent this ball cage from sliding all the way out so I don't lose the balls. Well, it turned out the screw out here was in a bad spot because it ended up hitting this rail here, just the edge of it, so that it will clear this one here. I also ground the edges of it a little bit. And now if I pull it apart again, I shouldn't be losing any balls. Once I grease up these slides, they'll attract dust a lot more, so I'm adding these strips here on the outside. Now with it back together, you can see that keeps the dust from getting in on this side, and then I've got this on the front that keeps dust from getting in on the front. The next step is to build the pantograph mechanism. I just cut all the pieces for the router mount, and I cut out the handle and these two links, and these links are going to pivot on pins like this. So now I have to drill some very accurate holes in these pieces. I'm gluing the links together in stages, and that way I only have to worry about lining up one thing at a time. This one is slightly smaller than the usual 89 millimeters. I just need to draw a different size circle on the template. Maybe a little too tight. I cut a tiny bit off of here and here where it rubbed the most. And now I'm actually pretty happy with that fit. I got this part of the router mount link glued up, and I was just checking, and this hole looks like it's to the right by about half a millimeter. I think I should fix that. But before I do that, I think I'll glue the last pieces on those two links. I fixed this inaccurate part by making another one, almost identical. And I glued together this part of the router mount link, just gluing on these square blocks. This will be the operator handle. And there's no way I'll get that hole straight enough with a thin drill, so I'm going to drill from this side and from this side and hope that those holes will just kind of line each other up when they meet in the middle. Well, it lines up well enough that I can get the pin in there. I've got a hole in here and a cutout on the other side, and this part goes in there. And then the knob goes on here, and when I tighten that, that locks it in place. Except I screwed up a little bit because I meant for that knob to be on the top, except I cut the cavity on the wrong side. So I'll just end up putting the bolt in the other way around and put the knob on here. I wanted to get a very snug fit for the shafts here, but now the fit is too tight. So I made a reamer by grinding a slot into the end of one of these shafts with an angle grinder. And I can use that to expand the holes for a snug fit. The most important aspect of these two links is that the shafts are exactly parallel. It looks like I have a tiny bit of play, probably about 0.2 millimeters, which I think is acceptable. Now let's make sure there's no twist in this thing. So I do have some twist in there. A 20 thou, that's about half a millimeter. With only a moderate amount of force, I can force that into compliance. I might have to fill one of the holes and re-drill it. This one's a little bit worse on the spacing front, but in terms of twist, it's only half as bad. I'll call that good. As if it's misaligned, I have to remake the part. So I set up this jig. This ensures the shafts are in a plane, and then these stops make sure that the shaft on the end, at least, is at a right angle. I can make sure everything is straight. These two links join the main support at the bottom, and they need to tilt against each other, except this hits here. Getting that second washer in place is really tricky, and I used an extra shaft to capture it in place while I pushed the main shaft through. And this is where the pantograph mount goes. Now I need to transfer the pilot hole locations. I'll start building the template holder, which goes right here. So those two pieces are going to go here, and I need a piece of plywood that goes on here. And I'm squaring that up as much as I can on the table saw. These slots would be much faster to cut with a slot mortiser, but I don't want this build to be dependent on machines that you might not have. I switched to a 3/8 inch spiral router bit, and that actually works much better. Not the nicest looking slot, but it's only for passing a bolt through.
I need to cut some slots for the actual template holder to slide up and down.
Now I need to glue on this one. I made a spacer and then cut that down the middle to make sure I have two pieces that are exactly the same length, and that will make sure these two pieces are parallel. This is the part that the templates get screwed to, and that needs to be able to slide up and down without tilting. So for that, I've got these strips that slide in this slot.
I'm gluing some extra blocks to the bottom of the template holder to give it more stable support.
It had been my intention to glue this one onto the plywood like this as well, but then I realized if I get any sort of wood movement here, the tolerances are so tight that this will jam. So I'll put it on with screws so I can adjust it later.
I'm using the tip of that screw to mark where the pilot holes need to go. I'm using the tip of a drill to mark the pilot hole locations.
The screws don't hold the best in end grain, but the solution to that is just to use a really long screw so there's lots of engagement. I drilled some holes in here for attaching templates, and the next thing I need to build is the table, and that's going to be this design here.
I have a thin spacer to offset the two initial cuts for a mortise, and then I have a thick spacer to offset that whole mortise and make it again.
Now for the other half of this joint, I just need to cut away where I previously left material.
And now gluing it together.
I just cut these notches square here because I still want support for the middle of the table, but if I have a clamp here, it helps to have a little bit more room.
Laying out the screw hole locations.
I want to get it to the point where I can do some test cuts, because I'm keen to see how well it works. So I'm checking that when I move across here, this moves parallel with the table. So I was planning on going into details on aligning this, but this is actually pretty close already. I don't think I need to tweak this. Now I want to make a template to make a half-inch tenon using a half-inch router bit.
I am adding a slot to the middle of the tenon template so I can also use it for cutting the mortises.
Came out way too loose. Let's see. Oh, 15 millimeters, supposed to be 12 and a half. Part of it was I was wiggling inside the slot and I had too much vibration.
notice I've got a bit of wiggle room, and that will also make for a slightly smaller tenon. I thought by tightening this enough I would get rid of this wiggle. The problem is I cut this hole a little bit too inaccurate. But for now, I'm just going to stick a nail in here, and that cuts out the wiggle room. Cut the mortise. I still had some vibrations on here, and seems to fit now.
So this clever way of locking the shaft on here really hasn't worked out very well. And this one was actually much easier to make, so I'll just make this whole lever again. I noticed that Chuck moves away from the square as it moves up. This mount is a little bit too high and I need to lower it a little bit. This edge is nice and parallel to this edge. In my next video, I'll make a plunge lever that'll allow me to plunge with a bit more control and depth stops to control how far this is going to go in. Now I need some kind of pin to join these together like this. A hacksaw would work too, but an angle grinder is quicker. For the pivot of this operating lever, I'm just going to use a big wood screw, which has got a long, smooth shank. The rotor doesn't need to come any further forward than until the chuck just about touches the table, and I have to make sure this handle doesn't hit this handle. Well, this does make cutting mortises dramatically easier. I cut a bunch of rectangular blocks that go here, 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 and here, and this shaft passes through them. Now I just need to drill a whole bunch of holes. I sanded all the corners smooth on the depth stop parts because I'll be touching those quite a lot. You can, of course, buy threaded plastic knobs, which are quite nice, but they're relatively expensive, so it's much cheaper to make your own just using coupler nuts. What I still need is some springs to help counterbalance the weight of the router, because it's very tiring having to lift up on the handle all the time. And now I need to attach this string to a spring, so I need to cut a notch right there. Now the other cam is the same shape but a different design, so I'll just use the one I just made as a template for that one. If I was following my plans more closely, I would have just drilled this hole much earlier.
And a bigger hole for the knot in the string.
So the spring needs to be just slack when this link is vertical, which means I need to tie the knot right about here. So these springs don't perfectly balance the weight of the router, but they take up most of it.
And I'm adding another little block to hold the end of this shaft.
I think I'll use this busted bar clamp for the hold down. I've carefully whittled out this shape so that now this clamp fits nicely in there. So this dowel along with the threaded rod helps to keep this part aligned, and I can put this in the regular position, or if I need to, I can make it reach out a little bit further. This screw goes through this hole in the clamp, and that keeps it from falling out. And then I can use that exact same fence as a fence for cutting mortises. So that completes this pantrouter build. If you want to build one of these machines, I have a more detailed video series as well as articles on my website, and also a very detailed set of plans for sale. Or you could buy a commercial metal version of this machine at hybridpantrouter.com.